Welcome to Animal Cafe, where you'll hear weekly interviews with experts and enthusiasts working to better the lives of animals, and a monthly segment reviewing fun, fabulous, and useful products for your pets. Check our website, animalcafe.co, for more.
Thanks for joining us at Animal Cafe. Today we're talking to Sherry Long, former CEO of the National Geographic School Publishing Corporation and now author of Dog Trots Globe, to Paris and Provence as Sheltie Goes to France. Welcome to Animal Cafe, Sherry.
Thanks, Mary.
I found your book to be a delightful read and visually stunning. Can you explain what made you think to write a book with your Sheltie Chula as narrator?
Well, we had the good fortune to take her with us to France. And on her first trip, she was just like a puppy, you know, how puppies learn all these new things. And she got to go to the big outdoor food markets and lived life under the tables and the bistros and heard people talking to her in French. And pretty soon I just kind of imagined what she must be experiencing, and I kind of got the idea to write everything from her point of view. So the book kind of came out as Chula's memoir and a little bit of just armchair travel to Paris and Provence. And we took the photos, which I think there are like 150 of them or something. And some of them are actually from her dog's eye view. So then we had her share impressions of what she learned about French cheeses and market days and lavender and sunflower trails as she went through them, and how the Eiffel Tower was painted, and that way there'd be things that she saw and things that adults would appreciate when they got to see this part of France.
It was really fantastic. I quite enjoyed it myself. How long have you been traveling with Chula?
Well, you know, she took her first trip when she was 9 months old from California to New Orleans by car. And that's where she first experienced hotels and elevators and all. And she traveled all around with us when we could go by car. But this was the trip 2 years ago to France was the first really long one and by air.
Mm-hmm. What kind of arrangements did you have to go through with the vet and customs and that kind of thing to get your dog's passport in order?
Well, there actually was some research involved, especially since we had never done it before, and we found out that the rules really varied by country. You know, France is just really a dog-friendly place, and on the other hand, if you go to England, your pets have to be in quarantine for quite a while, but in France, they can just walk off the plane and go away with you. So that part was easy, but there certainly was paperwork that had to be done, and in researching it, we found that she had to have a European Union health certificate that proved her vaccinations were in order, and she had to have a microchip implanted, which she already had. And then all of that paperwork has to go to the U.S. Department of Agriculture to get a stamp officially, and you pay a little bit for that. And you do that about 4 months, I think, is the maximum you can do it before the trip. And then you have to get an international health certificate from your vet within 10 days of the trip just to certify that the dog is still healthy and able to make the trip. So that was what was involved in the paperwork, but equally as important was making sure she had the right kind of crate that was the right size, and we figured out how to freeze the water so that it could be, you know, wouldn't slosh out and everything when she was being boarded, and that she'd have plenty of water for her trip. So there was some research to do in that area as well.
So what did you do about that, just as an aside? That's an interesting point I hadn't heard before about overseas travel.
Yeah. Well, you know, once we got the right crate and we made sure she was comfortable in it and loved it, had the right padding and all of that, then we learned about the kinds of food and water bowls that you can bolt directly to the crate so that the food doesn't spill out and everything. But the water is another story, and after trying a few different kinds of water bottles, we really landed on this idea of of putting the bowl in the freezer and getting it very cold, and then we made sure we were just getting to the airport in time, and it was still pretty frozen, and that way they were able to board her, and she didn't lose her water. So that was a good thing.
Timing, yeah, timing is everything. So, why don't you tell us then about your trip?
It was such a fun trip. I think in terms of us, you know, we were going to be there for 2 months, and we just couldn't bear to be without her for that long. And, you know, she found out that Provence was just her favorite place to be because she could go anywhere. And especially I mentioned the markets that she loved. And, of course, as she would stroll through the market, she'd meet the soap table, and that had lots of good scents. And Chula's like any dog, you know, she loves to sniff around. So the spice table and the sausage table, which turned out to be her passion, the paella man that she met, being able to kind of meander under the tables and find the goodies that were there, that those were great fun for her. And of course we loved going to the markets too. That sniffing continued when we happened to be there when the lavender was all in bloom, and she could go up and down the rows and just take her time kind of checking everything out. She kind of only got in trouble twice. Once she stole a baguette out of a market basket of the lady in front of us. And that got her in a little trouble. And she had learned all these new things about how dogs are supposed to behave when they're under the tables in the restaurants.
Yes.
And so she got to be very good about that. But one night a lady sat down a kind of cat-sized white purse, and she thought it was a cat, and she charged across the restaurant to get that cat. So, you know, she wasn't perfect by any means.
Old glares, I can see them now.
I know. And then we took her to Paris as well. And, you know, it's interesting, though there are 200,000 dogs plus in Paris, they just can't really go all that many places. There are all these no dog signs around on the museums and the metro and every park, believe it or not, just about. And so she still went out with us. She visited the Eiffel Tower and meandered along the Seine and went through all the neighborhoods, learned how to walk on cobblestone streets. And she got to go to a photography exhibit on opening night at a gallery there in Paris.
Wow.
So she felt like she had a Paris experience, but I would have to say, you know, going everywhere with her in Provence was just wonderful.
Did you get help booking certain hotels for your trip with regard to having Chula?
You know, we never had a trouble with the hotels because even in Paris, most of them will accept dogs for a fee, of course. And she can go in any restaurant anywhere all over France. So we didn't have issues there. We did find that we needed to book the plane in advance. There is a limit to the number of animals that they will take on any one trip. And if any of your listeners have small dogs, you know, they could go into the cabin. And I think most planes take one or two, and so you have to kind of think ahead if you're hoping to do that. Chula had had too many of Bob's good meals, and so she was a little too big to fit in the cabin. Had to stay in the hold. But still, we had to plan a little bit in advance.
Well, especially when you're sending things off to the Department of Agriculture.
Yes, right.
What event do you think Chula will never forget?
Well, that's easy. In the little village where we were staying, called Saint-Famille de Provence, each year on Whit Sunday, 3,000 sheep come into town, and there's a ring road around the town. They parade around that road three times, and you know, Chula is a sheepdog, right?
Yes.
She's not one who is actively working at the present time. And we took her to meet these 3,000 sheep and thought maybe some of her natural instincts would take over. but yeah. She was mostly pretty scared. And she ran and hid under a cafe table and
aww.
Knocked her water bowl over and all of that. But afterward, we took her up to the highlands where the sheep were headed, and they were having actually a lot of sheepdog trials up there. We thought maybe she'd mm-hmm. learn something. But that up there, she was much more adventurous and would go up to the pens where the sheep were and seemed to kind of realize that maybe she was a sheepdog after all.
It was just too much for her, those 3,000 sheep in a city kind of
thing. Well, she liked it. I have to say she liked it. And you know, we put it all on video, and the videos, if the book is available as both a hardcover and an enhanced ebook, and in the enhanced ebook, the videos of her at the market and this incredible day when the sheep came to town are all there, so you can kind of experience the same horror she must have felt when she first saw them.
Aww. That's great. I love that enhanced book feature. That's
yeah.
Really wonderful.
Great you can do that these days in books.
Yeah. Even if you can't hold it in your hands, I think that's a pretty great
yep.
alternative. So there are a lot of major differences between France and the U.S. and everyday life and how dogs fit into it and
yes.
don't. And also between towns, I guess, in France.
Yes. Definitely.
Interesting here that they can't go in the parks. That's...
Yeah. In Paris, there are about 3 or 4 places where dogs can run, but for the most part, you know, they're kept out. And in a way, you have to kind of understand this because certainly the museums, you know, the French very much value dogs, but you got to say they value their artwork more. Justifiably,
yes.
I think.
Oh, well, I understand you're going back to France in a few days.
We That's are next week.
Chula's going too, right?
Yes, she'll be there.
That mean that maybe there's another book in the offing?
Well, we'll see. We'll have to see how many more new experiences she can have. But, you know, April is the time when all the red poppies are in bloom in the fields in Provence, and I'm quite sure she'll be running through them.
Oh, and would make a lovely Monet, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I'm going to try to get her on video with all those beautiful red poppies.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Oh, so where can readers find out more about you, your Sheltie, and the book?
The publisher's website is a good place. It's oic-books.com, and there is more information about us, but there's also a lot of extras that have just, I guess, jam-packed full of information about Paris and Provence and an area called Dog Spot where you can find some good dog idioms and other fun things that Chula did, and all the information on the pet travel where the research that we did and wrote up to hopefully make it easy for other people to take their pets with them, because I just can't recommend it more highly. And, of course,
yeah.
the book is in ebook form and enhanced ebook form, so you can see samples of it if you go to the Apple iBook Store, Amazon, or other online ebook retailers. And hopefully people will have fun seeing Paris and Provence.
Oh, thank you so much, Shelley. Listen, keep us up to date on your travels.
I will. I'll send you some postcards. The electronic kind with pictures
yes.
of Chula.
Okay, we'll put them on our Facebook page then.
Okay, that sounds great.
Oh, well, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thank you, Mary. It was fun to talk with you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
You can find us on the web at animalcafe.co, on Facebook, and iTunes. Thanks for listening.